thank you so much. I've been trying to come to Design Indaba for the last 3 years. I'm going to show you a few pieces of my work in case you might not know my work. I want you to see it first, and then I'll dive in. I've really excavated my sketchbooks, and I'm going to show you some sketches that I have never shown to anyone before. I only just rediscovered them, so I'm going to dig into some deep, old, scratchy old process and talk about it. So this is an opera that I just made on a lake in Bregenz in Austria for a production of Carmen, and you'll see it's 25 meters high. It sits there for 2 years. This is the Beyonce formation tour that has just finished that some of you may have seen or be aware of. This is the final image in that show. Here is U2's Innocence and Experience tour, which is about to be reignited again next year. Some more from that show. This is Kanye West and Jay-Z, Watch the Throne tour, that you might also be aware of. And a small piece of theater in London called Chimerica. I still do work that's quite small scale for small audiences as well. A singer called Adele and her world tour. There she is, I'm sure you know her. And this is an opera by Wagner called Parsifal. And Kanye West again on his tour, Yeezus. When I was younger, I played the violin, and I also drew my violin. And it seemed to me important not just what the thing sounded like, but how it looked while it sounded, what went into it visually to make it sound like that. And I realize, as I look at what I do now, that I'm kind of designing musical instruments in a way, translating from voice to visual, creating visual voices. The other thing I learned while practicing the violin was practice. I understood just that incremental thing that many of the people in this room will be familiar with, that doing it again and again means you get better. And that the word practice is not just about rehearsing, it's about understanding that the rehearsal for your life is your life, and your daily practice to get better becomes your practice, becomes you. So understanding that from quite an early age became very important. Pagan ritual, East Sussex, southeast of England, gatherings. Whoever that is, let's hang out in a pub in Hastings soon. Gatherings, pre-Christian, anarchic. This is people throwing petrol down the street. This lodged somewhere deep in me, I think, when I was younger. It happened a lot. And then the other end of the spectrum was church, because I went every Sunday to a Catholic church in Rye, in Sussex. And this little curtain that you see and the stations of the cross that you saw and this, these were the props as I associated them. And I had a job to do in church. I was a participant. Me and my sister wore little matching skirts and we rang a little bell. And we had to know what all these props did. And to us, it was quite magical and mysterious that we learned the Latin Mass. We learned this spirit of translating from word into song. We learned congregation, the power of congregation. And we learned what the props were and where they had to go. And there was a nice order to that. And then these were the props I started working with later. This was a mad magician called Jean-Baptiste Thierry and his wife, who is Charlie Chaplin's daughter, Victoria. And one of my first jobs was being an assistant to this magician. And I could see very clearly the common denominator between all those Catholic props I'd been dealing with and then the magic table props. When I was a bit older, it was all about gadgets to play music. And there was a fascination during the 70s and 80s when I was growing up with the next gadget. And then the album covers. So for us, I guess, music was expressed through the album covers that people were designing, some of my heroes, and through the physical objects that were amplifying and playing the music. So I guess there was always this sense of, what's the visual version of the music? Is it the black, funny, plastic and metal gadget? Or is it this extraordinary artwork on the front of the cover? I loved The Cure, but they didn't come to the Tunbridge Wells assembly room. So I went for the Boomtown Rats, who had a similar album cover, and they did. So I was able to go and see them perform live. And I don't know quite what I was expecting from a live concert experience the first time I went in the late 80s in Tunbridge Wells, which is a small provincial part of southeast England. But I think I was expecting something like enlightenment. And of course, you know, I thought he looked handsome and that he would be there as well. And this was the Tunbridge Wells Assembly Room. This was my first pop concert. And it looked like that. It was a whole load of gadgets. There were no album covers there. It was all mashed together, instruments of amplification. So years later, when I was invited to design my first pop concert, I was keen to see, is there another way to translate from a singer's voice to a visual manifestation of that? So of course, I drew this picture, which I thought solved everything, in that it was a band called Wire, post-punk band called Wire, and there were four of them. And I wanted to say, how about if we don't talk about this weird eight-legged, four-headed, drummer's always a bit higher type thing, what if we try to express the combined organism that was the band? It seemed to me that that's what they were doing musically. They had a musical fusion, but not a visual one. So this is what we made nearly 20 years ago. And now it looks quite commonplace, I guess. But at the time, it was quite unusual to separate the band out into four boxes and to rig them up to heart reading machines so you could sort of analyze them as he went along until it fell off the drummer because he was drumming hard. So you get the idea, but it was literally a translation from a mouth into an image. And I was fortunate enough then to have a website, which was not a very usual thing at that point, but I had a mate who was designing them and he needed some money, so I said, okay, let's work together, make me a website. And Kanye West saw the website and said, okay, can you come tomorrow? The show's in 10 days' time. Can you come tomorrow? And it was my birthday, actually. I was in the Real Greek restaurant in Hoxton. It was a nice restaurant. And I abandoned my food because I thought this would be a good adventure. And I got on the plane. I downloaded all the lyrics, and at the time there were only two albums, College Dropout and Late Registration, so I studied those quite hard, and I studied the Wikipedia entry, which at the time was not too long. And what I learned quite quickly was that Kanye had, as you may know, suffered a near-fatal car crash just while he was recording College Dropout, and he had an injury to his mouth. So here you had a voice that literally couldn't get out. The mouth was wired shut, and he made a song called Through the Wire, which was about trying to sing while your mouth is closed. And it seemed to me very clear that this is what I needed to express with him in this show. So I did these sketches on the plane, and I said, look, it's all going to be about a curtain gradually cutting you off while you're trying to speak, and we will, you know, process for you those moments when you were looking in your car rear vision mirror. And he took one look at that and then a look at this, which was my other thought for him, which was he needed to somehow always be expressing the one and the many. I think his name means the only one. And I felt that that was the right thing to do. He didn't like any of those sketches at all. He liked what he'd seen on the website, and the show was in 10 days. So he said, look, he was much more realistic than me. I said, no, we can build anything. He said, no, it's in 10 days. Let's just build the boxes. So we made these little sketches. And we made a very simple show with pictures of his mum on it. And that's what we made for the first show. I came back to London, and of course you'll see from this picture, this is obviously the Pet Shop Boys, Neil Tennant and Chris Lowe, because who else would be mad enough to accept my suggestion of wearing a box on their head, which they did. Then I finally made it into an arena. And I knew about churches, I knew about theatres, I did not know about arenas. And I knew about this place, the famous Greek amphitheatre, Epidaurus. And the ritual origin of theatre, as you probably know, started here. Ritual and theatre were one thing. Worship and theatre, mask, character, ritual, were all part of one process. And Kanye probably didn't know about this place, but he did have a sense that he needed to bring nature into the theatre. So his instinct from then on was always to say, can I have a tree? Can I have a volcano? Can I have an iceberg? Can I have rocks? And I had been working in the theatre, and I knew that it was potentially or definitely going to lead to utter humiliation to make a fake plastic tree or a pretend rock, because the art of presenting in a theatre is in itself a very vulnerable art form, because it deals in the pretend, it deals in the fake, it deals in lies. And a lot of people want to use it, including myself, to say something true. And it's a central anxiety beneath the whole practice. How can you speak the truth when you are making fake things? How can you put a fake tree on the stage and expect anyone in the audience to believe a bloody word you say? So every time Kanye asked me for a tree or a rock, I said, no, it will never work. And we made a show called Glow in the Dark. These are some sketches that I've dug out that I haven't shown before. They're such terrible quality, but you get the idea. And I said, no, look, what if we just make undulating shapes? And he did this sketch on the plane and sent me that. I said, you know, we don't have to have real grass. You know, we don't have to have real sky. So we made this piece of work, Glow in the Dark. And then we said, are there other ways? Could we make a faceted mountain? Always coming up with this. Human beings in a mind. What's a mind to a king? What's a king to a god? What's a god to a non-believer who don't believe in anything? That was No Church in the Wild, and I first heard that piece of music in my studio in Peckham in southeast London, played straight off, hot from the studio. It hadn't been heard anywhere, and that's Frank Ocean's voice, which I don't really think people had heard too much at the time. I certainly hadn't heard it. And the little sequence I showed you is cardboard models that we were making all night while we were playing that record, because Kanye came straight with it from the studio, played it again and again and again, because he'd only just heard it. So we were just... we did spend some of the time in the car, because he didn't really like my stereo system. It wasn't good enough. Ironically. So we sat in Peckham on the street in this big black wagon, throbbing, listening to No Church in the Wild. And we iterated away and finally found that actually Afrofuturism back then in 2011 was the answer after many iterations, seen through a lens of Americana. And this was the ensuing work, Watch the Throne, two thrones made out of LED. Then it was icebergs. Can I have an iceberg? So we tried icebergs, but they were okay in paper, but it looked like they were going to be harder to make at a tourable scale. So again, we went back to images, courtesy of David Attenborough. It was always from the BBC. Any other wildlife footage was not right. It always had to be the Attenborough footage. In the end, we kept pushing this idea of making a mountain. I kept saying it wouldn't work, and finally we did make one. And I have to say, it came out of the dustbin, because there was Virgil Abloh, John Maguire, Vanessa Beecroft, and myself, all with bits of cardboard in a studio trying to make mountains that we thought wouldn't be humiliating. And Kanye picked the bits out of the bin himself and made this mountain model. And it struck me that, to a degree, what I had ended up making by trying to find visual expression for the voices of singers is a kind of mode of sculptural portraiture. This is a portrait of Parsifal in the Richard Wagner opera. This was Don Giovanni, the cunning little vixen. And once I'd stopped to take my breath for a moment, having really not stopped since my birthday at the Real Greek and running around making stuff, I thought I'd actually try to do this more consciously. So I said to Kanye, why don't we take the speaker, the means of amplification, and translate it into a device through which you can perform in the way that the Greeks would perform, through a mask. Can we not give you this as a mask? And I had been working on Hamlet, so I had been working with fencing masks. And of course, that seemed like the right way to tie the thing together. So I said, why don't we just tie you to the means of amplification through every part of your body? Why don't we completely knit the means of amplification, your voice, and you, your body, to it? But that never happened. I continued to be a bit more self-conscious now about the act of making portraits in my work. And finally, or not at all finally, but at a certain point, a singer came to me who very consciously has a stage persona. And it was the first time I'd really worked with someone speaking very directly about this. It's like the onstage person and the real person. And this singer, her mask is her eyes. Her mask is her eye makeup. And she has two voices. She's Adele, and she speaks like that. She comes from Tottenham, she speaks like that. But when she sings, she takes on this huge diva personality. So we could go into this quite consciously. I started sketching ways because I had begun to realize that anything I made in this environment, I wouldn't sketch these two screens at the side, but whenever I turned up in an arena, guess what? These two screens turned up. And I'd say, but I've made this beautiful thing in the middle to translate from voice to visual. And you are taking everybody's attention and peripheralizing it. You're taking everybody and splitting their gaze in two. Nobody's looking at my performer. They're just looking at these two close-up screens. So I gave up the fight. I said, well, actually, with a woman artist whose mask is their face, whose visual voice is their face, let's just declare that and let's work with it. So I was exploring ways that I could do that more sculpturally. And here's what we made. And this was the start of the show. Shouldn't cut her off, should I? I'll tell her. I'll text her that applause. With someone like Adele, an audience has been waiting to see this person sing. They want to see the voice. And she had tried to tour. It had been aborted. Her voice had packed up. There was anxiety. Would she do it? This was the first night in Belfast. Would she even come out? Would she be scared? And really, what I'm crafting, my clay, is the audience's anticipation. Every moment that they've queued on the phone, they've queued outside to get the best seat, they've saved up the money, whatever they've done to get there. So that's the thing to not be squandered. And much of my craft is how to mete out that anticipation, how to deliver on it, how to not fuck it up, actually. Rule one. So Beyonce, then. Having learnt the lesson, put the face in the center. She was writing at the time an extraordinary piece of work called Lemonade, autobiographical agitprop, actually. And it seemed to me clear that one needed to express the conflict, the division in the huge persona and the tension between the grandeur of the persona and the human object, the human person, the barefoot creature caught in the maelstrom of the persona. So I made these sketches, which I haven't shown to anyone before. My sketches are, the worse they get, the harder I'm thinking. So I quite enjoy the bad ones, because I know I was having a good idea. Hands, the translation from the grand scale to the human. And I wrote on this sketch, big pop star hand lets little human fall. And that's how I felt we should start that show, that she should be held up in her own enormousness and make clear her own human quality, humanness. But we didn't do that. We did do this, though. We made a big object that revolved. And these are the kind of sketches that I have kajillions of, because they're always in series. I think maybe, I've seen a lot over the course of the last few days of people thinking in series. I think it's what we do. I always thought it was because I looked at those stations of the cross on the wall. I always thought in series, thought of one thing leading to another. So I only really ever draw one thought leading to the next. A process of kinetic sculpture and film always combined in the drawings. And I was battling, I always battle with rectilinearity of the materials that I can work with. I'll say a little bit about the brutality of working in touring rock and roll. It's really hard to do good work. It's really hard to do delicate work. It's really hard to do curves. It's hard to do anything that doesn't come apart like a piece of Meccano and load on and off a truck very easily. So these were little studies in how could I, with a rectilinear object, bring some organic distress to it? Could I perforate it and allow messy, organic effluvia to come through orifices of it? Could it cry? Could it puke? Those are my questions of the LED screen. Could they cry? Could they puke? So these were the images that I showed Beyonce in order to evolve what the show would be. And they're kind of photo montages, really, more than anything else. They're not really renders. And then finally, once we've agreed what it's going to be, it gets really technical. It's big, beefy old structures that have to withstand wind and rain and so much. There's so many opportunities for dilution at this point. And everything that you had put into these sketches, into these photo montages, becomes a problem and becomes an opportunity for technical solutions. And this, just to give you an idea of the number of hours you have to put these mighty beasts up. And how many men? I remember the first stadium concert I worked on, I was breastfeeding my small baby at the time. And I was in this giant cafeteria in Stade de France, or Parc des Princes in France. And everybody was a man. They're all sitting around me in their blue overalls, because you have to be. You've got to build this thing. There's a few women in there, but it's mainly very butch men building that stuff. So there you go, anticipation on toast. And there they are, setting it up. It struck me when I was putting this talk together that this image is remarkably similar to the wire image of literally a mouth. And that image splitting apart happened. The effluvia through the eyes happened. The series, the train of thought. And in this case, dealing with the audience's anticipation was affected by the technical limitations of what I could build. Because I had envisaged this thing turning round about that pace to reveal Beyonce. But the fastest I could get it to turn was 5 minutes. So the anticipation really, luckily, survived that 5 minutes. But I won't put you through the whole 5 minutes now. You get the idea. Another diva, and at the time, she had been, much of the discourse around this particular singer was around her tongue and what her tongue did, and what her arse and her tongue did at the same time, tonguing and twerking and tonguing. And I had a meeting with her, and it was quite a short meeting, and I just said, why don't we do the whole show on your tongue, Miley Cyrus? And she said, sure. And that was it. And we did this really bad sketch, and that was that. Took it. I said, okay, we'll do one of these. But of course, tongues are not the right things to do a show on, it turns out. Too hard to do a tongue. I said, what about this tongue? No, too hard. Hard tongue. So I made a shorter tongue, and for a moment while I was sketching, her face became a house. And something that happens to me quite a lot is this correspondence between something abstract and something concrete. Why should a portrait not also be a piece of architecture? I read a book when I was 16. It was called The Memory Palace of Matteo Ricci, and if you haven't read it, I recommend it. It describes a mnemonic system, which you may know about, memory palaces, which help you to remember things by ascribing a place, an architectural place, to every abstract thing you need to remember. That stayed with me. I probably think about that book every day. More sketches, getting worse and worse, the harder I was thinking to try, how can I do this tongue? Because by now we'd realized, as you can see, we couldn't do the show on the tongue, but we could perhaps allow Miley Cyrus to enter her show by sliding down her own tongue. And so here's me now doing a sketch. I really haven't shown anyone these sketches before, but it's quite fun. I said, oh yeah, could it be inflatable? How can we do this tongue? And then I got my little scale rule out. Could it be a telescopic tongue? And you realize why these set designs get so terrible, because you start talking about telescopic tongues, it's only going to lead to humiliation. So I showed her a few of these photo montages. She said, okay, that's good, let's do that. Yeah, that's how she came out. Here we are. The person making this video was so excited, they shook. And you can see it only got worse from the sketches. How humiliating. But it had to happen, you know? Once you've said you're gonna make someone slide into their own show down their tongue, you have to deliver, you have to do it, no matter the humiliation involved. Wait for it, she's coming. She's so coming, she's coming. There she is. Her mum dressed her under the stage. It's her mum putting on her outfit. We have to let her slide before we move on, don't we? There she is. So, obviously Stonehenge next. Thank you. Said it to Miley. But when I watched that video and some of the beautiful ways that the work has been presented over the last few days, I thought, oh, geez, I'm showing some crappy YouTube video. But I was too busy. I was dancing. I don't think I was filming anything. But it struck me that often there's a question between, should you be rigorous or generous in design and in what you make? Can you be generous and rigorous? That's the ideal. But when you're given a choice, if I was rigorous, I wouldn't have shown you that. I probably wouldn't have made it. I would have said, oh, it's going to be shit, let's not do it. But I wanted to be generous. So between generous and rigorous is often a real dilemma, isn't it? Stonehenge, on the other hand, I've never watched. There is a film called Spinal Tap, I've heard, with a small Stonehenge in it. I'm never going to watch it, because people say my life is like it. I don't want to watch it, so I'm not going to watch it. But I did visit Stonehenge. I spent time nearby. And it strikes me that we do want places to congregate. We want those places. We want to gather en masse, don't we? We want to hear voice. That's why we go out to the stadium or to the arena. It's not easy to get to. It's hard to get out. You have to queue. It's all difficult stuff. But where do we congregate? Where do we gather to sing together and to listen to voice together? We've been doing it here for a few days. We've been congregating. And we're not singers. We're people who make visual images, but we've been trying to use our voice in a gorgeous spirit of collective support and camaraderie and humility. But where are those places? It was actually a band of five men. They used to be boys, and then they grew to be men in a very public way. And what you find with bands is they're tribes, and this tribe wanted a totem. They wanted a place of gathering. They wanted to give it a totemic focus, an amulet. And I said, well, okay, let's make you a giant man, and you five men can stand in the hand of it, and it'll stand up. And you notice I didn't draw any screens, I didn't draw any speakers, I didn't draw a stage. I just said, yeah, that'll be enough. We'll just have a man stand up in a stadium. And the band is a boy band who grew to be a man band called Take That. And they were crazy enough to say, yes, let's do it. But they did want some rectilinearity. So I said, okay, well, what about man and machine? And having been thwarted by these lights and sound systems and speakers that were needed, I thought, well, what? Maybe the man can, you know, maybe the man can, you know, hold the whole thing up. Maybe the man can do the job of holding up the side screens and the speakers and all that stuff. And then, of course, here's the budget. It got very technical. I had to sit down and point to everything, say how much it was going to cost, and the five boys, men, had to say yes. And then, of course, it got translated, and here's where, you know, the dilution, potential dilution starts. And, of course, the most important drawing of all was this one, because you can't make a giant man unless, on a truck, he will fit under the lowest bridge in Hamburg, because everything has to fit under that bridge. Otherwise, it can't tour. So these are the parameters you're dealing with. And then you make it in foam and fiddle around and keep working until finally, here it was, a big man. And I'm going to play you a little video of this man standing up. It takes a little while because the big machinery is a little slower than I would have liked, but... Notice I didn't show any pictures of those men, those singers. Oddly enough, because I guess I felt that the object we were making was a translation of their purpose. And you can ask a sculpture to do that translation for you. With a singer called Abel Tesfaye from a band called The Weeknd, the translation was into something more abstract. The object of collective focus was an aeroplane, a flight path to express and manifest his journey from the streets of Toronto to what he is now, which is a man only quite a man who's not that tall. So it was also helpful to have this directionality that could always point him out. Sometimes it's ideas that are really simple, isn't it? I mean, it was great when Adele spoke earlier and he said, yeah, I want the message to be got immediately. You too. Another tribe of men who didn't need to see their faces, didn't need to express through a mask. They wanted to express through a road they grew up on. So the road got extruded into a screen that you could perform inside, straight in the middle of the arena, and then being revealed and concealed within it, playing with scale on it. And the piece I showed you a little bit earlier, Carmen on the Lake in Bregenz. For me, this project overcame some of the things I've struggled with because the speakers are in it. It is actually a speaker. This is a little cardboard model of it. And then the acousticians populated it with speakers, so they're not hanging there, as Johannes was mentioning earlier, those gloomy prophets of doom speakers. They're actually inside it. And this piece, if you'd like to see it, it'll be coming on again in July and August, in Western Austria. I began to realize recently that something was happening in the work that I was making. At the beginning, when a singer finished the show, they would come up to me and say, how was it? And I would show them some carefully curated, chosen photos and say, look, it was great. They go, great. Now, of course, it's a sort of... When you walk into a pop concert, you're walking almost into a 360-degree rig of cameras. And it's cubist, in a way, because the thing's being documented from every facet and being shared as this organic group photograph. And I've started making some work myself that doesn't use any voice other than my own, which, at the grand old age of 46, it's taken me a while... But I decided I would try. And the first instinct I had, having learnt how people enter into each sculpture in their minds through their machines. I thought, well, what if they could really walk through the screen? What if I could make a sculptural film and say, actually, you don't have to be outside it and sort of have that relationship between the priests and the congregation or the performer and the audience. What if you could walk through a hole in the film? What if there was that means of entry? What if the film had a mouth? So the film could sing, but the film could also allow you to enter its voice. So I made a piece in Peckham called Mirror Maze last year, which involved me showing my working process, my hands, and saying, can you please come in? And people did. They walked through and they found themselves in a mirrored environment. This is another piece which followed on the same train of thought called Room 22 in Miami last year in December. That's back to Peckham. I'm going to play you now a film from the Miami piece, My Voice.
I woke up to a single line of light, my only point of reference to anything. I didn't know which room or which country or where the door was. I knew only this single line. And that the longer I could know nothing but this geometry, the more I might discover. I picked up the line. It drew a hotel, room by room, floor by floor, everything mirrored and connected. It seems like a leap of imagination, doesn't it? To extend this fantastical geometry from a single line. But it's nothing, is it, really? Compared to what we all need to agree to believe every time we stay in a hotel. That the room is ours. That the guests before us left no trace. And those that follow us will cast no shadow. It's a subtle act of strenuous imagination, isn't it? To unsee the opposite version of the room through the wall. To undraw the pipes that pass and beds that pair from one room to the next. To unhear our many breaths cycling into sync across our multi-story sleep. And I wonder, what effect might this magic have if only we could pour it down the corridors? Would they bend and wrap around one another? Would they pick up speed and start to spin? Could they be sliced through and mirrored? So we see over walls and find each other in fragments and reflections.
So that was the first time I felt able, having been a sort of surrogate, I guess, for other voices, which I will continue to be, but to use my own. And I think I only probably reached that place because I started hearing my own voice quite a lot because I was reading stories to my kids. So I just got more used to it. This is a piece that drew from having seen these audiences full of their little telephones and their lights. I thought, why don't I make a piece out of that? But why don't I now, having invited people to walk through a film, could they contribute to it? Could they be part of it? So this was at the Victoria and Albert Museum over Christmas. It was called The Singing Tree. And I invited everybody to donate a word. I worked with a creative technologist from Google to form an algorithm trained on 25 million words of Victorian poetry. The words that were donated were put through the algorithm and also through a sound algorithm. And a poem was written, and I was surprised, actually, at what came out. Each word was projected onto small white pieces of wood, and this is how it sounded. Is something that one of the reasons I'd never come to Africa before was I wanted to make sure that when I came, it was to really engage, to really understand. I didn't feel it was a country I could just sort of wander into as a tourist. And the days that I've spent here over the past 3 days, it started with Sunu Gonera inviting us all to find our voice, to share the voice. And I've been so overwhelmed by the spirit in which all of us have done that. And I want to make a small show a final video, which I hope is a sort of manifestation of what I think the spirit of this place is, of Indaba, which seems to be, can you translate from a thought to a word to an action? And can you do that quite quickly, please, and quite immediately? That seems to be the spirit of impatience over there on my left. So I'm going to leave you with a final little video that I hope is a manifestation of that spirit. Thank you very much.